Now, let's come to the respiratory emergencies. Now, the respiratory emergencies, we know that the it should be the emergencies, respiratory emergencies are the most commonest emergencies. If I come to the neonatal emergencies, then it should be evaluated properly and taken care of immediately. Now, let's go with the pathophysiology. I will not go into detail. Respiratory distress syndrome at birth is basically because of surfactant, deficient surfactant production, which basically seen in preterm infants, which is called as hyaline membrane disease. And the treatment is to go ahead and give the surfactants, but I'm not going to go ahead. Decrease atrial expansion leads to respiratory distress. Now, the second most important cause of respiratory emergency is bronchiolitis, which is a viral infection leading to the respiratory failure. Now, the bronchioles in this case becomes inflamed and increases the secretion production. Now, the normally bronchiolitis is caused by RSV, your rhinovirus, enterovirus, and coronavirus, if I say now. And third is the meconium aspiration syndrome, which basically is immediately after birth. So let's see what are the signs of respiratory distress and what are the signs of respiratory failure. What is the differentiation between them? Now, in respiratory distress, a child will have tachypnea, there will be retractions. The abdominal accessory muscles will be used. There will be nasal flaring and tracheal tugging. But in cases of respiratory failure, which is basically because it is mostly central nervous system mediated, there will be apnea, there will be bradypnea, hypoxia or hypoxemia, there will be carbon dioxide retention. And the baby, if you go ahead with the ABG, you'll find a respiratory acidosis. So this is how you, these are a few points which I can just try to reiterate that you have to distinguish between a respiratory distress versus a respiratory failure. Now, what is the difference between an RDS and a bronchiolitis? I'll just go through fast. Age, RDS, first 2 days of life. Bronchiolitis, as we all know, I have studied first 2 years of life. Etiology, I have discussed decreased surfactant. Bronchiolitis because of a viral infection. Signs and symptoms, we have already discussed. Diagnosis, yes, it will be a clinical diagnosis and a chest X-ray and management with RDS, supplemental oxygen, fluids, surfactant, and ventilation, and then a CPAP support later on. Bronchiolitis, suctioning and supplemental oxygen. Please note that most of the times you don't require any antibiotics in bronchiolitis. Normally what we do is we just start with a battery of antibiotics, which is not required in bronchiolitis. Good supplemental oxygen and suctioning is very important in treatment of bronchiolitis. Now, the chest X-ray finding, like I told you, is the most commonest in newborn diseases. Now, in respiratory distress syndrome, like I told you, hyaline membrane disease, it's a ground glass opacity, decreased lung volume and air bronchograms. Pneumonias, we can find focal opacities, diffuse infiltrates, and foreign body aspiration, we know air trapping on the side of the foreign body. Now, interventions, if the child comes in apnea in the emergency, immediately go with a bag and bag wall mask ventilation, intubate the child and go ahead with the mechanical ventilation. If mechanical ventilation, I would suggest that before mechanical ventilation for apneas, you go with the bag wall mask ventilation. And if you can put a high flow nasal cannula, or if that is not possible, then you go ahead to go with CPAP support, which normally treats the apneic spells for a baby and find the cause for that. If that also doesn't suffice the situation, then go ahead with the intubation and mechanical ventilation. Severe distress, like we told, CPAP support, intubation and ventilation. Now, in severe distress, remember one thing. Now, the CPAP support, if the FiO2 requirement is 40 and less than 40, CPAP support will obviously help the baby to will basically treat the distress in a baby. But if you find that the baby's requirement is more than 40%, even on the CPAP support, and if the distress is not settling down, then think about going ahead with intubation and mechanical ventilation. So the point where you have to take a call is a baby on CPAP support requiring the FiO2 of more than 40%. With the respiratory distress, which is intercostal subcostal retractions, grunting, grunting, which is not going low, then you please think about going to intubation and mechanical ventilation. Moderate distress, like I told you, high flow nasal cannulas and CPAP support. minimal distress, go with nasal prongs or high-flow nasal cannula again. Now, let's come to further surfactant. I told you supportive care of management is such thing, supplemental oxygen in case of bronchiolitis. Salbutamol, normal saline, or hypotonic saline nebulizers have not shown to improve outcome in bronchiolitis. Like I told you, no antibiotics, no nebulizers with the bronchodilator, they will not help. Only good oxygen support and good suctioning is the prime for the management, prime management for bronchiolitis. And if you find that there's a clear viral etiology, then you consider antibiotic coverage. Now, see, I've shown this X-ray. Now, you can see the first X-ray is basically the HMD, which is the ground glass appearance. And the second X-ray, you can see pneumonias and the streaking, which is basically the reticular pattern, which you can find in the third X-ray.